Well, thank you very much, Dr. Kent, for that very kind introduction. And I'd also like to thank both Dr. Kent and Dr. Chen for extending the invitation for me to come speak today. It's such a pleasure to be here. I'd also like to thank Dr. Sippel for helping to organize my stay during these couple days and making such a nice agenda. So it's, as Dr. Kent mentioned, it's a particular pleasure for me to be here, not only to speak today, but also because, but also because Madison is my hometown. Coming back here always reminds me of the really lovely things about Madison that I enjoy. You know, beautiful views of the state capitol, the great football games here, the best frozen custard around, Michael's frozen custard, and beautiful views of Lake Mendota. But I will admit that coming back here in January also reminds me of the one thing that I don't miss so much, which is all the snow and cold. But despite that, it really is a pleasure to be here today, and I'd like to thank you very much. So today, we'd like to talk about the topic of gastric cancer. And what I'd like to start with is the background and staging of gastric cancer, particularly for those of you where gastric cancer isn't your main focus, or surgical oncology. And then focus the majority of the time on the approaches and challenges to applying MIS to the treatment of cancer, but specifically some of the challenges involved with bringing this technique to gastric cancer. And then towards the end, I'll briefly touch upon a couple emerging applications for minimally invasive surgery with hereditary diffuse gastric cancer, and then some of the interesting research correlates, one interesting project that we've been developing recently with xenograft models. So as far as gastric cancer statistics go, as of 2011, there are approximately 22,000 cases of gastric cancer diagnosed per year in the United States. Sadly, about half of those patients will die of the disease. And that's largely because in the United States, we have no good screening for gastric cancer. And most patients who present, present in late stages, where resection isn't an option. More men than women develop gastric cancer here. And although there has been a decline in gastric cancer in the United States since the 1930s, interestingly, there has been an increase in the incidence of gastric cancer, particularly of the GE junction and proximal gastric cancer, such as cancer of the cardia. The good news is that over the years, there has been gradual survival improvement. When you look at statistics of overall survival, from the 70s to the 80s to the 90s, but overall survival rates of 27%, still a lot of room for improvement. So if you look at a recent publication from Hundal in 2000, looking at the US National Database for Gastric Cancer, he looked at surgical outcomes of all comers in the United States. This database contains about 50,000 patients. The overall statistics show 63% one-year survival and 28% five-year survival. Poorer survival for males, also poorer survival for proximal tumors and also diffuse tumors or signet ring cell tumors. The problem with this database is that when you look at the surgical staging of these patients, 27% of the patients in this database had no lymph nodes recorded or an unknown number of lymph nodes. More than half of them had fewer than 15 lymph nodes, and only 18% actually had 15 or greater lymph nodes. So for gastric cancer, one of the most important predictors of recurrence and overall survival is lymph node status. And our minimum number of lymph nodes that are required in a resection to have adequate staging is 15 lymph nodes. So this is an important point and one of the limitations of a national database. So looking at our institution, we have the fortune of being able to see a very large number of gastric cancer patients a year for the United States. Now, these numbers are small compared to what you would see in Korea or Japan. In those countries, the incidence of gastric cancer is 10 times what we see here. But nevertheless, at my institution, we're fortunate enough to see somewhere between 200 and 250 patients with gastric cancer a year. Now, about half of those patients end up being unresectable. But of those patients who are resectable, I show this graph to give you an idea of what the distribution of stages of the patients that we see. And if you look at T stage alone, you can see that in the, this is by 5-year intervals, we used to be seeing mostly late stage patients also, patients with T3 or disease. But over the years, that paradigm has changed. Now, in the past 10 or so years, we are seeing patients that are pretty equally distributed, T1, T2, and T3. So with this opportunity of seeing patients with earlier stage gastric cancer, it has also opened up the opportunities for different applications of technology, such as MIS. Just to give you a quick view of what the survival looks like, it's not quite as dismal as 27% overall. The survival for stomach cancer is very stage specific. So even if you're looking at the difference here between, this is data that looks over a 15-year period, over 2,000 patients from our institution, you can see that even the difference between stage 1A and stage 1B patients, the survival changes dramatically. And this is largely due to the number of lymph nodes that are involved. But the 5-year survival is somewhere in the range of 85 to 95% for early stage stomach cancer. Even when you get to stage 2 gastric cancer, the survival drops quite markedly, but still roughly 55 to 65% 5-year survival. Stage 3 and stage 4, you can see down here, the survival is very different and more consistent with overall national statistics. So the staging for stomach cancer, to review that for those of you who don't see this frequently, at our institution we require 2, if not 3, tests in order to appropriately stage our patients. Endoscopy with EUS is perhaps the most important test to help determine how we're going to treat our patients. Most patients will come with an endoscopy, and they'll come with a CAT scan. A CAT scan, chest, abdomen, pelvis, is necessary in order to have the staging complete. If you suspect the patients have locally advanced or advanced disease, then a PET scan would also be appropriate. The endoscopy with endoscopic ultrasound is very important because this will help us to determine the depth of invasion of the tumor. You know, patients will come in and say, well, the tumor looks small, so, you know, I must be ready for resection. But we explain that it's not the size of the tumor on the inside, it's how far it's grown through the wall of the stomach that's important. And that's information that our EUS will tell us. Not a perfect test, but it's the best preoperative clinical test that we have to clinically stage the patients. Early stage disease, those patients go on to operation. Patients with locally advanced disease, T3 or node-positive disease, those patients will go on to get chemotherapy followed by an operation and then adjuvant chemo. And this is based on the MAGIC trial, one of our large trials that was published several years ago that shows the benefit of neoadjuvant chemotherapy and adjuvant chemo in improving overall survival. And this was really a landmark study that changed the way that we practice for patients who have locally advanced disease. Before those patients can start this process of chemo and operation and chemo, almost a 9-month process, they need to undergo diagnostic laparoscopy. And this is a very important preoperative test for patients with who are about to start chemo, because we'll find that even with a negative CAT scan and a negative PET scan, a certain percentage of these patients, up to 20%, will actually be found to have occult metastatic disease. And that's something that you only can tell with peritoneal cytology. And we'll discuss that in just a minute. Patients who have positive cytology will not go on to have a resection. Those are considered M1 patients. They receive palliative chemo. Here, the endoscopic ultrasound, therefore, just to emphasize this point again, it evaluates the gastric wall invasion and local regional lymph nodes. The problem with this test is that you do need an endoscopist who is very experienced with this technique. So you need somebody who you can rely on, because at our institution we make our very important decisions for the patient based on this test. The laparoscopy, we perform this in a separate setting, so that's one disadvantage of this test, but it is an important one. Patients come in for a separate setting, general anesthesia, same-day surgery with about 20 minutes in the operating room to evaluate the peritoneum, the liver, surrounding organs, and visualize the tumor on the stomach. And then we obtain washings in the left upper quadrant, right upper quadrant, and pelvis. They go home. About 2 or 3 days later, we get the cytology results. If they're negative, they're on the curative path, the curative potential path. Now, just to emphasize how important cytology is, this is a paper from Bentram that he published with data from our institution in 2005. And looking at patients who had almost 350 patients who had R0 resections, so curative intent resections, these patients had cytology obtained at the time of operation. They went back afterwards to look at the results of survival. Patients with negative cytology, all comers, all stages, you can see what the survival curve looks like. For those patients who had positive cytology, not known at the time of resection during this paper, you can see that their survival, we basically had, no survivors beyond 3 years, so equivalent to M1 disease. So we've been using this procedure as an important part of our workup for many years. Recently, the AJCC has now adopted this as part of the new staging system. So cytology is now considered M1 disease according to our official staging guidelines. Another paper by James Mezier, one of our fellows who graduated about 2 years ago, was published last in 2010, Annals of Surgonc. You can see with the red line, these are patients who had cytology-only disease. In other words, their diagnostic lab was clear, no visible signs of tumor deposits, but the cytology was positive. These are patients who had visible tumor deposits. And you can see that even with cytology alone positive, the median survival 15 months compared to 9 months with visible disease. Just to emphasize that point once again. So what about patients who are resectable? What are the indications for minimally invasive approaches for gastric cancer? So when I started in, we'll start with a few points of historical interest. The minimally invasive approach for gastric cancer is a relatively new field. In fact, the very first laparoscopic resection for a benign tumor was reported by Dr. Dennis Fowler in 1991. After this, the first report of a laparoscopic distal gastrectomy with lymph node dissection for cancer was reported by Professor Kitano from Japan in 1994. 96, the first lap total gastrectomy with D2 lymph node dissection by Dr. Izagra in South America. And it wasn't until 2005 where the first randomized prospective study was published by Dr. Heuscher from Italy. We'll review his paper in a minute. Perhaps the landmark paper for gastric cancer in the West. So from that time onward, there have been many publications on laparoscopic approaches for gastric cancer, but the majority of these are from the East. Very few publications from the Western world. So whereas this page, I could fill up 4 or 5 pages of Eastern studies. This summarizes basically all of the studies from the West, with only 4 reports from the United States. And then the randomized prospective study we discussed from Italy with Dr. Heuscher. So you look at this and you wonder, why is it that minimally invasive approaches for gastric cancer haven't taken off here the way they have in the East? So in looking at how to approach a minimally invasive, apply a minimally invasive approach for gastric cancer, we had to do a lot of thinking about what are the important issues to applying this technique. So the first one is you need to prove that when you're applying a new technology that there is oncologic equivalency. If you're not doing the same lymphadenectomy, and if the survival is not the same, then you really can't offer the technology and that application to a patient. Secondly, for minimally invasive gastric surgery, there are technical challenges. It's not an easy operation to learn. You need advanced laparoscopic skills. And the anastomosis, particularly for total gastrectomy, is a challenge. We'll review that in a minute. And the lymphadenectomy has to be complete, a good D2 lymph node dissection. And then lastly, the learning curve. How many of these cases does one need to do in order to be technically proficient. So for oncologic equivalency, there are about 16 high-quality retrospective studies in the literature, 4 randomized prospective studies that are of significance that we'll review. The first one was by Professor Kitano, published in Surgery 2002. He looked at 28 patients, all with early-stage gastric cancer. He randomized them to LAP or open approaches, followed them for 2 years, looked at various postoperative factors. He found that the laparoscopic approach, as expected early in a learning curve, took longer than the open approach. However, the lymph node retrieval, no different. And you can see above the number, the 15 cutoff that we need in order to have good staging. He also found that over his period of follow-up, there were no tumor recurrences, but these were all very early stage cancers. So he didn't quite prove equivalency in survival, but he did show that oncologic factors such as margin status and number of lymph nodes could be adequately achieved. He also found many of the benefits that we know from the minimally invasive approaches, less pain, better post-op FVC, and so forth. So next was Dr. Heuscher's paper from Annals of Surgery 2005, which I think is one of the sentinel papers, especially for us in the West, because he took 59 patients with all stages of surgically resectable gastric cancer, stage 1 through 3. So these were patients of all stages. He randomized them to LAP or open approaches and then followed them for 5 years for survival. He also looked at many short and long-term outcomes, found, of course, that the minimally invasive approach, less pain, shorter hospital stay, the things you would typically expect. But the most important part of his paper was that he showed that disease-free survival at 5 years was equivalent between the LAP and open approach. And I think this set the stage to tell us that you can perform this procedure safely. When you perform it well, there is no difference in survival with the two approaches. Dr. Hayashi and his group published in Surgical Endoscopy 2005, another 28 patients, early gastric cancer. This is a group from Japan. And randomized to LAP or open approaches, 3.5-year follow-up, again, emphasizing the same points, less pain, shorter hospital stay, earlier oral intake. He also looked at some inflammatory mediators. He found that operating time, again, longer, LAP versus open. The number of lymph nodes dissected, no significant difference. He also found some inflammatory mediators, C-reactive protein, interleukin-6 levels were lower. And then the last paper, Dr. Kim and his group from Korea, published in Annals of Surgery 2008, 164 patients that they randomized with early gastric cancer, LAP versus open, 3-year median follow-up, primary endpoint disease-free survival, secondary endpoint quality of life and morbidity. Again, operative time took longer. The number of harvested lymph nodes, there was a significant difference, but you see 39 lymph nodes versus 45. You know, we still completely above the minimum for an adequate staging procedure. Hospital stay shorter and less pain. He also found that quality of life was significantly improved with the minimally invasive approach. And that was on various different factors that he looked at. The most important point, again, no difference in recurrence rates of LAP and open approaches when looking at 3 years of follow-up. So now that the oncologic equivalency question had been, the groundwork had been set, the next issue that I'd like to talk about is the technical challenges. Not an easy operation to perform, especially when the lymphadenectomy is a very important part of the cancer operation, and then the anastomosis. So we'll go through a few of those details. To do a laparoscopic gastrectomy, this is the typical setup that I'll use. With the patient in the split leg position, the surgeon operating between the legs, first assistant to the right, and then to the left, the second assistant. You can use various port sites. I tend to use 4 5-millimeter ports and 1 12 port here. So the first step, of course, is the retracting the liver with a retractor. You have the with a Nathanson liver retractor, This is a view of the stomach. Now, it's important that you are able to do intraoperative endoscopy. Sometimes the tumors are small, and that's an important component and skill that I think most residents have at this point. There's a lot of endoscopy. I'm very glad that I learned that during my training. The first step is to resect the greater omentum. Here you can see the omentum being flipped up above the transverse colon. And by getting in through this space just on top of the transverse colon, this allows entry into the lesser sac and also dissection of the transverse colon. You see a peek of the posterior stomach behind this veil of tissue here. And that's really the first step to begin this laparoscopically. And to grab onto this piece of stomach and pull it out allows for and facilitates the continued dissection of the omentum off of transverse colon. So then getting to the gastroepiploic vessels down towards the duodenum, this is an important part of the dissection. And what I have done here is I have two video clips just to demonstrate that when you're learning this technique, it's better to start with somebody with a lower BMI than a higher BMI. This is a patient with a BMI of 30. This patient has a BMI of 40. And just to give you a sense of how much more difficult it is to do this procedure, especially in the beginning, you see the pancreas here. It's covered by a veil of fat. The view here is easier. You can see the vessels more readily. The gastroepiploic vessels are coming into sight here. Transverse colon is down here, posterior stomach being lifted up. But you can see that in the heavier patient with that extra fat, as all of you who do minimally invasive surgery or open surgery know, it makes it more difficult to see the planes. It's easier to get into the pancreas. This is the base of the gastroepiploic vessels here, and it can be difficult to differentiate the lymph node tissue from the pancreatic tissue. That's not something that's great in the first few cases. Once you do have these vessels dissected and the entire lymph node packet elevated upward, you transect the gastroepiploic at the origin, at the very base, and take these lymph nodes up along with you. Here you can see the vessels again. Even though this video finished faster, this one actually was much easier to do. I just edited this one a little better. And here again, you can see transection of these vessels with this lymph node packet being brought up along with the specimen en bloc. Then the next step is the right gastric and the common hepatic lymph node dissection. So liver is up above. Here you see the pylorus below us, and then this is the area of the right gastric. Even though the right gastric is a named vessel, it's actually kind of small. You can take it with a sonosurge or with a ligature device. You don't need a stapler. And sometimes in a patient with a greater BMI, like in this patient, you don't completely visualize it as you're coming through with the harmonic or with the sonosurge device. But this entire lymph node packet needs to be dissected and brought en bloc along with the specimen. Here, coming up and under the stomach, you can see the stomach is being retracted upward here and here, again in the thin patient and in the heavier patient. You can see how much easier it is to see the left gastric vessels. Here, they're being clipped and now divided. In the patient who's heavier, you see the pancreas covered by a layer of fat here. The vessels are in this bundle of tissue, but hard to visualize. And this is not what you want to do in your first 10 or 15 cases. It's much more treacherous to do this dissection. This is part of the D2 lymph node dissection. So you want an adequate and complete dissection of this lymph node packet that's brought up. And then a stapling device or clips can be used to come across the left gastric, as shown here. Then the pericardial node dissection. This is coming up towards the top of the stomach. You see stomach here, hiatus coming into view up here, and in the heavier patient up here. You can see that even with very good retraction, having the patient in reverse, steep reverse Trendelenburg, the omentum and all of this fat just gets in the way. It's technically much more challenging. You need great assistance to help you to do the first few cases. Ideally, it's good to do this with a two attending approach in the beginning, and again, to try with the thinner patient first. And you can see this whole lymph node packet. Here's the right cruce of the diaphragm. The esophagus is being held, is being lifted upward here, coming behind the esophagus and pulling this lymph node packet down. And here coming around the short, through the short gastrics. Now, the one thing that's actually easier to do laparoscopically, I think, is the transection for total gastrectomy. You can see the esophagus here. You have a beautiful view looking up at the hiatus laparoscopically. And with a linear stapler, you can come right across the esophagus, as shown here. So once you've done this, now you have to put it back together again. So that is more of a challenge. There are different techniques for putting together the stomach after a total gastrectomy, linear staple technique or an EEA circular stapler. I'm going to show you the technique that I've been using probably on the last 40 or 50 total gastrectomies that I've done, whether lap or open. It's the Orville anastomosis. This video clip is courtesy of the company to show you how this OG tube with the anvil that's attached at the end is passed down so that you can actually insert the anvil without having to make a purse string suture. And this probably has saved about 30 minutes or so of operating time as opposed to placing the anvil in through the abdomen, making your hole. Once the OG tube is visualized at your esophageal stump, you can actually bring it right out through a hole that you make here. And this is a technique that's frequently employed with bariatric surgeons. Bariatric surgeons here would be familiar with this. And you can see this OG tube being pulled down with the anvil attached at the end. You want to make sure to tell your anesthesiologist OG. I had one who wanted to put this in as an NG tube. That was, we caught that just in time. You need a good jaw thrust to get this anvil right around the cricopharyngeus. But you can see a beautiful view here, and this is why I want to show this clip, of this 25 French EEA passing down the esophagus. You can see it passes down atraumatically, and it's coming down nicely as you're pulling the tube out. And then when it gets to the end here, you actually see the anvil. It actually flips into place, and you cut this suture, and then you can remove the OG tube and your anvil is set. In the meantime, you're preparing the roulem with the circular stapler in place. This is back to the case here with the anvil set for our total gastrectomy, and then the EEA is actually connected to the spike is inserted, and here you can see the completed anastomosis with a very short blind limb here, which is stapled off at the end. And this is just more of, this is another case, another total gastrectomy, showing the OG tube coming through the esophageal stump again. So this technique has really facilitated the anastomosis for me personally. I know there are other centers that have been using this technique as well, especially in Japan and Korea. And but this part of the anastomosis does take a lot of skill and really does take some time to feel comfortable with. So having said that, how many of these cases do you need to do in order to feel technically comfortable and proficient at the technique? The best learning curve series that I have seen have come out of Asia. This is a paper from Japan. And what they did was they took one of the senior surgeons who had performed 1,000 open gastrectomies during his career. I mean, numbers we just don't see here. And he decided he wanted to learn the laparoscopic approach. He went into the trainer box, learned all of the laparoscopic techniques, and then they decided to track his first 100 laparoscopic gastrectomies. I mean, just these numbers are just incredible. Many of the hospitals there actually will see somewhere in the range of 400 to 500 gastric cancers per year at their hospital. So they clearly have been able to answer this question faster than we can. They tracked his first 50 and then second 50 cases. And they found that the learning curve was met at about 50. The number of retrieved lymph nodes was adequate, but after 50 cases, his lymph node retrieval improved. His operating time clearly improved as well. And complications, post-op stay, all of the things improved. And they concluded that 50 was what they think you need to achieve the learning curve. Another study, which came out of, this is out of Japan, the other study was from Korea. This was from Japan, and they took three different surgeons who all had had experience with 1,000 open gastrectomies in their career. They also learned the laparoscopic technique, and they tracked each of their first 100 laparoscopic gastrectomies. And they divided it by 20 case intervals. And what you can see here, which I think is very interesting, by the time they had done 80 of these procedures, the operating time was better than their open times. So they really had become technically proficient at this. And that just speaks to the learning curve and application of technology. With regard to lymph nodes harvested, by the time they were really experienced with the technique, they actually were getting better lymph node harvest laparoscopically than open. Ultimately, they concluded about 60 cases is what they thought a surgeon needed in order to become technically proficient. So this is a little bit of a problem in our country where many hospitals are not even seeing more than 10 or maybe 15 gastric cancers per year. At our hospital, so far to date, we have done about 185 laparoscopic gastrectomies. We are trying to improve and increase those numbers. And with seeing more and more early gastric cancer, we've been able to facilitate more applications for this. Even patients who have neoadjuvant chemo will now be candidates for a laparoscopic approach. Just to give you an idea of learning curve numbers that we've found, tracking about the first 37 cases of lap distal gastrectomy with B2 anastomosis, so one anastomosis, you can see that the times do come down. By about 20 to about 30 cases, the times are more consistently coming down. I would like to point out that this very first bar here was my very first lap gastrectomy, which I performed with the assistance of Dr. Cho, who's here. It was a memorable case, but actually not the longest one. That was the second one, thanks to Cliff. But anyway, just to mention that. Operative times of lap subtotal gastrectomy. At this point, more experience at our institution with distal gastrectomy. So even though there were two anastomoses and a harder operation, with more experience, the learning curve was achieved, I think, more quickly. You could argue, at least from the first 20 lap totals, that we may still not be there in terms of the learning curve. And this is one that probably will come closer to the 40 or 50 mark that they mention in the East. So we did publish our first 30 patients with laparoscopic gastrectomy from our institution in 2009. We case-matched patients, lap versus open gastrectomy, matched them for stage and for BMI, and looked at short-term recurrence-free survival just to get a sense of what our numbers looked like. What we found, like the Asian studies have shown, operative time was longer, length of stay shorter with decreased pain. Interestingly, complication rate significantly lower in our laparoscopic compared to our open groups, and we chose to look at this a little more carefully. What we found was that in the lap group, there were many of the complications which were less. Most of them were minor complications, wound infections, other delayed gastric emptying, one anastomotic leak, one delayed gastric emptying. In the open group, there were fewer minor complications, more major complications, including one anastomotic leak, some abscesses, a wound dehiscence. So we thought this was quite interesting. And again, these patients were matched by BMI. We then also looked at late complications, any patient from 1 to 6 months. In the lap group, there were no late complications. In the open group, there were complications that we noted. Interestingly, what you would expect from a laparotomy incision, ventral hernias, and other complications that are a result of the technique of the operation, the open as opposed to the small incisions. So, and of these three patients who developed ventral hernias, two of them had a return to the operating room in order to fix the ventral hernias that had become very problematic. So we did find that interesting, and we're continuing research to look at that. Short-term recurrence-free survival, we need longer follow-up, but there were no major differences. In the next couple weeks, one of our papers, we recently completed a meta-analysis of randomized prospective trials with one of my fellows, Dr. Vinuela from Chile, who is a gastric cancer surgeon there. It should be in EPUB in the next 2 weeks or so. I just reviewed the page proofs. We evaluated all high-quality trials comparing lap and open approaches with this meta-analysis technique. We used the modified MINOR scale, which is a tool for quality assessment of non-randomized controlled trials. All trials are given certain points. And then out of the studies that we searched, 38 of them were eligible according to this MINORS scoring scale. And we included 6 randomized control trials, 32 non-randomized, which met the criteria. We stratified the studies by study type and by odds ratio and looked at difference in means. So what this meta-analysis showed us was that mortality of the two approaches, similar, that I think would be expected. Overall complications, however, lower after the laparoscopic approach, so it held up with the meta-analysis. Interestingly, major complications not significantly different, but minor complications and medical complications, such as pneumonia or UTI, were significantly different and in favor of the laparoscopic approach, again showing that some of the benefits we might offer patients are in terms of complications that will decrease their stay, but may have a significant impact. Operative time was longer. Most of the cases included were early learning curve series. Blood loss, hospital stay shorter after the minimally invasive approach. Interestingly, harvested lymph nodes were fewer after the lap distal gastrectomy. However, the median number of lymph nodes different was 3.9 nodes. So, and the odds of having less than 15 nodes, which is our cutoff, was very similar in both approaches. We found that after, in most of the series, about 40 to 60 lap distal gastrectomies were what would be required to achieve the learning curve, and there was a significant improvement in operative time, about 30 minutes faster once you had reached this learning curve. Improvement in number of nodes, and also improvement in the incidence of post-op complications, fewer post-op complications. So we found that the meta-analysis did support our idea that the laparoscopic approach compares favorably, may result in lower lymph node retrieval, but that could be due to learning curve issues, and as long as you're meeting the minimum oncologic standard of 15 nodes, it's acceptable to continue. And it's really established as a valid treatment for early gastric cancer in the East. We still need to prove it in the West, but I think we're getting there. So to briefly touch on two last topics, emerging indications for minimally invasive cancer, minimally invasive surgery for gastric cancer, hereditary diffuse gastric cancer is an ideal candidate for the minimally invasive approach. So for those of you that haven't seen much hereditary diffuse gastric cancer, about 1 to 3% of gastric cancers are hereditary. It's a mutation, it's a CDH1 mutation that can be tested for by genetics. And the way that you identify it, the International Gastric Cancer Linkage Consortium has developed criteria. It's a long set of criteria, but the gist of it is that if you have two or more cases in a first or second degree relative with one prior to 50, or more than 3 cases regardless of age, you should be tested for this gene. If you test positive for the CDH1 mutation, those patients should be offered a prophylactic total gastrectomy. It's a big thing to offer someone. The problem is, what is the timing of this? The risk of getting cancer when you have this mutation is low before the age of 20, although one cohort of patients in New Zealand, there was a girl who was 14 when she developed gastric cancer, signet ring cell gastric cancer. The important thing is that there's an 80% lifetime risk for these patients to develop gastric cancer by the age of 80. you're almost sure to get it. And the type of cancer is signet ring cell gastric cancer, which is devastating. It's a very aggressive type of cancer. And the average age of developing gastric cancer is 38. So these are important decisions that very young patients have to make. And one of the things that a total gastrectomy is a big enough operation as is, they also don't want to have a big incision on their belly. When you look at all of the series of prophylactic gastrectomies, this is basically the world's literature at this point. There have been about 101 cases done. I think just in the last few weeks, two additional series have come out with 10 patients each. The reason I show this slide is that the average age of the patients who had gastrectomy was 38. All of these patients had endoscopy ahead of time, multiple biopsies, no evidence of cancer. They underwent prophylactic gastrectomy. Of the 101 prophylactic gastrectomies on final path, 93 of them, or 92% of the patients, had foci of signet ring cell cancer in their stomach. I mean, it's just an amazing number. These were just ticking time bombs waiting to happen. So these patients really do need to have this procedure done. But again, to tell someone in their 20s or early 30s that you need your whole stomach out, it's a tough conversation to have. The advantages are that you can cure them, and it also eliminates the need for surveillance, even though the data is now mounting that endoscopy may miss occult lesions. The disadvantages is that there is significant mortality and morbidity risk for total gastrectomy. The leak rate at our institution is somewhere on the range of about 10%, and a leak can mean extra hospital stay, possible return to the OR. It's not insignificant. And there are also long-term nutritional issues. At our institution, we've done 9 prophylactic total gastrectomies. 2 of these have been done laparoscopically. And what you can see here is the average weight loss of these patients, about 12% on average, looking out 6 months, about 28-pound weight loss. It depends a little bit on their starting weight. But the patients, and we had 2 complications, a duodenal leak that was managed non-operatively, and an esophageal leak also managed with drainage, luckily no reoperation. The patients do watch very carefully what happens to the index family member, because usually there are about 10 or 15 family members waiting who have the sacrificial lamb who has the first gastrectomy, and they see how they do before they decide when and how they're going to have their procedure done. The most important principles for this kind of gastrectomy is that you have to check proximal margin and distal margin to make sure that you actually see esophageal mucosa and duodenal mucosa. In other words, you have to be sure that all at-risk stomach tissue is gone. All the gastric tissue has to be gone. The one interesting part about a total gastrectomy for these patients is that lymphadenectomy is not required. So far, there have been no cases of positive lymph nodes, even when small foci of early signet ring cell cancer have been present in the specimen. So it does make this an easier laparoscopic total gastrectomy without the lymph node dissection. It should be offered to these patients. The laparoscopic approach is an ideal way that it can be done and should be considered for these patients, and although the timing is debatable. And our one last thing, if we have time, is with all of these patients that undergo resection, we collect tissue and samples of tissue that we put in our tissue bank. We have been developing different research correlates from this. One of the exciting ones that we just presented last week in GI ASCO was our establishment of primary gastric xenografts. So Dr. Janjigian, one of our medical oncologists, has been leading this effort with our group to establish xenograft models from gastric cancer specimens. All of the patients who come to our institution sign informed consent under our institutional tissue procurement protocol. So a piece of everyone's tumor goes into our bank, but in addition into this xenograft study now, we collect blood from all patients, so we have germline DNA comparison, and the fresh specimens from resected tumors are directly implanted. 1 gram of tumor is needed. We inject those subcutaneously into the flanks of immunodeficient mice, and then have been working at developing xenografts. Our goal is that with these xenograft models, we will be able to better understand the different types of gastric cancer, which we don't have time to go into today, but also to develop better targeted therapies for our patients as well. Here's an example of one of our poor little mice, our SCID mice, before and then 2 weeks after implantation. This was one of our successful xenograft growths of a primary GE junction gastric cancer. This shows the H&E staining from that mouse, the tumor specimen from the human tissue, and then this is the specimen from the mouse xenograft. Our pathologist confirmed that these are identical in histology, invasive adeno, intestinal type moderately differentiated. The xenografts are hard to establish. Of 32 cases that we have attempted implantation, we have been able to establish only eight xenografts, but we're really pleased with these eight. This gives you a sense of what they look like. About four of them are proximal cancers, three of them are distal. Only one signet ring cell cancer, which has surprised us a little bit. These aggressive cancers we thought would be easier to grow in a xenograft. They've actually been the hardest. Primary tumors and three metastatic lesions as well. Some of them have been treated with chemo preoperatively or with radiation, some untreated. So in summary, the laparoscopic approach for gastric cancer is safe, it's feasible. The oncologic results are equivalent, although clearly we need better long-term follow-up. And it provides so many additional benefits that we know are inherent to the minimally invasive approach: improved quality of life and probably fewer complications as well, although the learning curve is significant. So I think as far as the minimally invasive approach, it's oncologically sound, it is feasible, and should be offered to patients who have gastric cancer. So I'll take questions in a minute. I just wanted to briefly mention that it's really a pleasure for me to be here also because my father, Dr. Eberhard Mack, is here. And he was on faculty here for more than 30 years, and I just wanted to say that without his constant support and his mentorship, I definitely would not be here and I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today. So I just wanted to thank you.